Welcome to Talks at GS. My name is Brian Levine. I am Global Co-Head of Equity Trading and Execution Services. Very excited to be here today with Mark Cuban, who I've known for over 20 years. Goes back to the mid to late 90s when Mark was pitching his IPO to go public, which is broadcast.com, and we pitched and actually lost the bake-off.
Yep.
And not that we're too competitive at Goldman, but that still bothers me 20-something years later.
Should have had a better pitch.
Well, I'll say this, though. If it didn't open up 250%, I think that the pricing was a little bit off by our competitor, but...
No, that was by design, because we wanted the bigger advertising impact, media impact, but that's okay. You guys didn't see it.
Yeah. Mark, as people and everyone who here knows, Mark's the most recognizable, one of the most recognizable entrepreneurs in the country. He essentially pioneered streaming entertainment via the internet through broadcast.com, and, as many people... may not know, he really did this to solve his personal problem, which was to listen to his beloved Indiana Hoosier basketball team play after he moved to Dallas after college. As people know, he's obviously also the owner of NBA's Dallas Mavericks, as well as one of the stars on Shark Tank. So to begin, I would just like to ask, before we talk about the Mark Cuban that everybody here knows, if you could go back to the Mark Cuban that started his first job selling garbage bags door to door, being a powdered milk salesman, and giving dance lessons. I think you said to meet girls. If you could go back to the late 70s and talk to that kid, and say, explain everything that's happened over the last 40 years, would he believe you are where you are?
Oh hell no! Are you kidding me? I mean, I grew up. My dad did upholstery on cars. My mom did odd jobs. My mom, when I was in high school, was worried about whether or not I could have a career, and made sure she hooked me up with a family friend to learn how to lay carpet, because she wanted me to know a trade just in case things didn't pan out if and when I went to college. So yeah, it wasn't like, oh yeah, this is destiny, and my parents are going to hook me up, or I knew this was going to happen. It was, who the hell knows what's going to happen, but I was all in for wherever direction it went.
Right. On a similar note, so at age 27, you had no money in your bank account.
Yeah, that was fun.
And you borrowed a few hundred dollars from a friend to start a software company back in the days when software was not a thing yet. You ended up selling for a few million dollars in 1990, bought by CompuServe. Did you know that this idea had to succeed, or is this just an example of the Mark Cuban mantra of, doesn't matter how often you fail, you only have to be right once?
Well, okay, let me get the timeline right. So I went to Dallas after college because a bunch of my buddies were down there, and I got a job working as a bartender at night, and was looking for a job during the day, and got a job working for a retail software company. And this was in the early days of PCs, and was doing okay there. And then about 9 months in, I was living six guys in a three-bedroom apartment, and I was sleeping on the floor. It was the rattiest, nastiest shithole you've ever seen in your life. I mean, and I literally didn't have a closet, didn't have a drawer. All my shit was in a pile on the floor. I had my one towel that I stole from Motel 6 that had a hole in it. That was mine. And so I was trying to grind it out and learn tech, which I really realized that I loved. And one day I called up my boss, a guy named Michael Humecki, H-U-M-E-C-K-I. And I said, Michael, I've got this deal I'm going to close. Now it's $1,500 commission to me, which meant I can move out of the shithole. And so I said, now, one of my responsibilities was to open up the retail store, make sure the door was open, the floors were clean, and all that kind of stuff. I said, look, I've got this big deal. I want to close it. And he said, no, you need to be at the store. I'm like, I got someone to watch. He goes, no, you need to be at the store. So I made the executive decision that if I went and picked up a $15,000 check for this company, Your Business Software, he would see the light and all would be good. And I'd have my $1,500 commission. Fired my ass. Seriously, Michael Humecki. And so,
I'm assuming you've spoken to him since then. Or
one time, literally, after broadcast.com went public, he sent me a letter asking if I would invest in his company.
You should bring him on Shark Tank.
Anyway, so that was the only time I've talked to Michael Humecki. And so, and so he fired me. And so there I was, still in the shithole with my one Motel 6 towel. and no bedrooms. And so it was then that we started Micro Solutions, and I had no money. And so I went to this company called Architectural Lighting, and I said, look, I got nothing. But I know you were trying, you want this time and billing software. If you front me the $500, I'm going to start this company, and I promise you that I'll make it work. And if I can't make it work, I'll walk your dog, I'll wash, you know, your car, I'll do whatever to make it up to you. Just trust me and give me the shot. They did. I took that $500, spent $250 on the software, got that to work really fast, and then asked for referrals and built this company that then went on to become one of the first companies that did local area network. This was the early 80s, and then went wide area networks, and as you said, we sold it to CompuServe. And along the way, I kept on reinvesting, and one day I went to the ATM, and I had all zeros, you know, which was not fun. But like you said, we ended up building it. We had $36 million revenue run rate and sold it to CompuServe, which was part of H&R Block. And, you know, all was in alignment again. And it wasn't like I started it thinking, okay, if I fail, I don't care. It was purely out of necessity. I didn't know what else to do.
Do you think that's a prerequisite for successful entrepreneurs in the sense that, you know, obviously you've met so many? And, you know, your story, you know, may not be as rare as I think we would probabilistically assume, you know, the ability to grind and, you know, get through those tough times. And do you think that that's something that's consistent with all entrepreneurs, or?
Depends how old you are. You know, a 45-year-old entrepreneur, 60-year-old entrepreneur is going to be different than a 24-year-old entrepreneur. What was I going to lose? I mean, literally, I had a Fiat X19 that had a hole in the floorboard. I mean, you could tell I was living the high life, right? I mean, and I was putting in oil every 60 miles and, you know, working as a bartender at night. What did I have to lose?
Right.
You know, and so it wasn't like, oh, man, you know, this is, I could lose all this. And so it was just like, you just go for it. Right. Now, later on, after I'd had some success and we got back and we started AudioNet, which turned into broadcast.com, the math was different. The equations, you know, the calculus was different. It was like, okay, I'm investing a lot of my saved money into this whole idea of netcasting, right? Or internet broadcasting in early 1995 when people didn't even know what the internet was. That was all risk because I literally was putting everything that I had on the line for something. People just laughed at me and said, wait, audio over the internet. You know you can turn on the radio. You know you can turn on a TV. Yeah, but you don't get it. No, that's just dumb, all right? You know, and so being able to overcome all that resistance, because remember back then, A, you had to have a PC. B, you had to know what a modem was and install it. C, you had to know what the internet was, and then you had to download a TCP/IP client that worked over a modem and then connected to a browser that you probably didn't even know what it was or how to download it. And we had to take it on faith that all this was going to grow.
Right. And what you're saying here is really contrarianism, right? Meaning,
yeah,
like, you have to have a very strong contrarian belief and very strong opinions, which, you know, I'll connect this to the fact that you're also one of the best traders that I work with. And, you know, to some degree, you know, I used to speak to all the time back
then. I killed it back then.
And, you know, when I said that I had met Mark on the Bake Off, it wasn't actually the Bake Off. Mark actually, when he was in town in the office, he actually pulled up a stool next to me. He was one of our more active private client trading clients in Dallas. And he used to trade a lot of the local companies, I2 and whatnot. And I remember him vividly saying to me that Netscape is going to zero. And as strongly as you would imagine, Mark, you've been saying that. And those were back in the days where Netscape's stock price was telling you anything but that. And you talked about, you know, there's no barriers to entry. And, you know, obviously Microsoft, you know, just bundled it. And, you know, it seems to me that, you know, for trading, like, that's an extraordinarily important characteristic. And contrarianism, conviction, and, you know, to fight the herd.
It's a lot different back then than it is now. So, you know, Micro Solutions, that first company, was effectively a systems integrator. And so, and this is the mid-90s, you know, so we sold it in 1990, but I stayed up to date on all the technology. And so late 80s, early 90s, I had been integrating and installing, you know, throwing out some old and Wellfleet routers, you know, Synoptics, you know, all these, you know, Bay Networks, yeah, Cisco, Bay, all these names blast from the past.
I know the symbols that are coming back to me.
Right? And so I had installed them, so I knew what worked and what didn't work. And back then, you had analysts that, you know, covered the really biggest companies, but you had all these new technology companies that were up and coming, and they didn't understand them.
Right.
You know, or I'd walk into CompUSA and I'd see what was selling and what wasn't selling or how they configured things. And I'd be like, done, 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 short that, short that, short that, buy that, buy that, buy that. And it was taking candy from babies, right? I mean, and so I was making 80, 90, 100% a year. And a lot of people don't know, we actually started a hedge fund that I sold within 9 months. I mean, it was just so easy. And, you know,
so easy.
That was different because there's so much money chasing so few stocks. Back then, there were, you know, 9,000, 10,000, you know, if you include the NASDAQ and the Amex and everything, public companies, and so many of them, the new ones in particular, were tech stocks. Now there's, what, 2,500 public companies or whatever, you know, and so it's a lot more money chasing a lot fewer companies, so it's hard to find the outliers.
Right. It's interesting. I think it's less efficient. So anyway, sticking back to the timeline, so it's 98. You take broadcast.com public.
Yep.
It's up 250% in the first day. It was the biggest one-day pop in IPO history.
That was a fun day.
Yep. It was underpriced, but that's a...
But I was going to tell you a story. So we're in New York, right? And we're at the NASDAQ. And we're like, so we're taking bets on what will it open at. You know, we priced it at 18. And we know it would pop. And I'm like, 35. And everybody, no, you're crazy. 22, 23. And it didn't open. It's 11 o'clock. Doesn't open. 12 o'clock. Doesn't open. Finally, about 12:30, 1 o'clock, it opens. Bam, 63, and it goes up to $72. And so then a couple hours later, it closed, and we had to go to Frank, what's the name, old time Wall Street bar? I don't know, it has one name, it's like a guy's name.
Harry's.
It's and been so,
a long time.
Harry's. And so we had CNBC on there, and every time they said broadcast.com, we had to take a shot. So I was sound asleep, you know, 2 hours later. But I got back up. But that's a whole nother story. Yeah,
so that was 98. Those were obviously heady days.
Yes, they were.
You know, if I didn't mention this, I traded the internet sector for Goldman at the time too. And a few months after the IPO, Yahoo bought out broadcast.com for $6 billion. Yep. You remember the date? I remember the date, and I'll tell you
April 1st. Yeah, it was April
why?
Fool's Day.
April Fool's Day,
yeah.
1999.
Yeah. Closed in July, yeah.
It's been said that that was one of the worst acquisitions. The question I wanted to ask you was, well, not from Mark's standpoint. The question is, did they overpay in the top of the dot-com bubble, or did they not execute on the plan?
They didn't execute. First of all, they paid in stock. It wasn't cash. So their stock was as inflated, if not more. And so they paid in stock, and think about it. If you could go back to 1999 and have the company that dominated streaming, right? So we had hundreds of internet radio stations. So we were Pandora and Spotify, right? We had really started video. We dominated all video streaming on the internet. It wasn't even close, right? There was no YouTube. There was no anything else.
6-7 years before YouTube.
YouTube, right? So, you know, radio stations, online music, customized radio stations, customized video. We were, you know, integrating advertising, doing indexing of the spoken word and all this kind of stuff for index.broadcast. And if you can go back and say you get to own that entire industry for $5.7 billion in stock,
right,
that would have been a hell of a buy.
Right. So how did they mess it up? What do you think?
Because when the bubble burst, they just freaked out. I mean, and look, they did so many stupid things. Like they owned the patent to pay-per-click. They had bought a company, and Google's entire business was built on pay-per-click. And Google had violated that patent, admitted they violated that patent, and Yahoo let them off the hook for, I think, $133 million in stock, which ended up being worth $1 billion. But had they kept that patent right, and said to Google, nah, you know, so think about it. Dominating the entire streaming industry, preempting Google from even existing among any number of things. I mean, you can even argue GeoCities was social networking before anybody else. They just freaked out.
Right.
And their board stepped on them and said, no, we're not going to invest, and we're going to go back to cash flow positive because there's no money to give. And broadcast was actually cash flow break even by the time they started doing all this.
Right.
It was crazy. And so, yeah. Oh, it was a great buy for them. It just didn't execute.
Speaking about great buys, so that acquisition netted you about $1 billion. But I think what's somewhat underappreciated was, you know, Mark couldn't sell his stock, but actually at that time, and this is within months of the dot-com boom ending, structured a collar, a hedge that we helped structure and trade for him, which is essentially, you know, you have an asset and you sell an out-of-the-money call, which caps your upside. In the money that you take in from that, you purchase a downside put, an out-of-the-money put, and if it goes down, you're going to monetize your position that way. Right. Mark put that on, obviously.
But that was the second trade. The first trade, so the way the rules were structured, let me take a step back. First of all, because I told you I traded and had a good understanding of trading, and I had watched in the 80s, you know, these PC companies go bam, bam, Eagle Computing, names you wouldn't even remember, go bam, bam, bam. Then I watched software company, WordPerfect, you know, Ashton Tate, you know, WordStar, all these companies, bam, and then networking companies. I mean, it didn't take a genius to say, wow, this might happen again. And so the first thing I did the minute we sold, I wasn't allowed to put on a collar for 6 months because of the laws. And so what I was allowed to do was find an index, an internet index that didn't have Yahoo as more than 5%. I took every penny that I had, literally every single penny that I had, and bought puts on that index that got me to the point where I could put on my collar. I lost 90% of that, of those puts. But I was able to put on my collar on the other side, and you know, the rest they call one of the top 10 trades in history. Yeah.
So your success as an entrepreneur has obviously led you onto Shark Tank, you know, which is now in its 10th season.
That's crazy.
A couple of Emmys, and it's really become a pop culture phenomenon. Why do you think that is?
You know, it's funny. I came on in the second season as a guest. Mark Burnett called me up and said, you know, we've got the show. They'd been bouncing around from night to night. I'm like, yeah, I'd seen it. You guys could really use me. And and so I went on as a guest for 3 episodes. And I'm thinking to myself, this is a business show. It's bounced around. Who the hell wants to watch a business show? But so I'm going to go in there with guns blazing, right? I'm just going to dominate this thing. And I made some of the stupidest deals and bought some of the stupidest companies. You don't want to know. But then they got renewed for a third season, and in the third season, they just started going bam, 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 bam. And they put us on Friday nights, which was supposed to be a death night at the time. And the numbers just kept on going up and up and up and up. And I was like, oh, okay, this might actually work. And it's just kept on going from there. As far as why, I think one reason is when we were on Friday nights, at least, it was the number one show watched by families together. Parents loved the fact that their kids would watch it. So they try to get them to watch, and they would watch, and they'd watch it together. Because parents still to this day, I think, want their kids to get excited about starting companies and understanding entrepreneurship, or even just understanding what their parents do for a job, you know, and understanding the rudiments of business. And so I think just that desire to get kids excited about the American dream was one piece of it. And part two to that was, we all are entrepreneurs or wonder if we're entrepreneurs at heart. You know, we all have that idea inside of us. We've all been through it. Oh, I got this idea. It's a great idea. You know, and you get all excited. You get that feeling in your stomach, right? And then you go to Google and you Google, oh, there's nobody else doing this. Ah! Then you call your friends. You go, what do you think? What do you think? Oh, that is really cool. I'd buy one. You know, and then most people stop. You know? What's for dinner? But some people, they found their way to turn those into companies, and they found their way onto Shark Tank. And we got to see examples of people from any little town and any, you know, anywhere in the country with backgrounds that weren't from some big Ivy League school. Maybe you didn't go to college at all. Maybe it was their last dollar and they started it up, and they were desperate to get an investment, but they started it. And we showed examples of people who were willing to take that first step and start that company and where it could go. And I think that really, and to this day, really excites people and gets them, encourages them, and really shows them that there can be an upside. And on the flip side, you know, there can be failure too. And so you have to be realistic about what can happen.
Right. So you just mentioned that there were a bunch of investments that you made in Shark Tank that you kind of regret. What is the biggest miss in all the seasons you did it, that you just thought there was no chance and it became successful?
Oh, I thought there was no chance it became successful?
You thought there was no chance and it became successful. When your biggest miss?
Oh, that I didn't invest? Oh, look, it's like old girlfriends. You forget about them, right? Seriously, the show is... Okay, so background on Shark... Anybody watch Shark Tank? Yeah. Yeah, if you turn on CNBC, you can't miss it. It's the worst.
It's on the trading floor constantly.
Yeah, right? Because I put on CNBC and I hear my voice. Oh, it's brutal. But once a deal is done, you can't remember it, because when we go to shoot, we shoot probably 2.5 weeks in June and 2 weeks in September. And we get there on the set. Well, Kevin and some of them get there like 6 a.m. because they need a lot of makeup. And I get there, like 15 minutes before we start shooting, put on my suit. But in any event, we start shooting and they just bring in deal after deal after deal after deal. And any given day, we'll see 10 different deals. And if they're really stupid, they'll take 30 minutes. And if they're really intense and there's competition or it's a really interesting business, it might take 2 hours. And so once you check out, and you're no longer interested, you check out. You know, you're thinking about 100 other things. And so, and over the course of all these years, 250 pitches that we see a season, I couldn't tell you.
What was the best one you've done?
The best one I've done is a company called Cycloramic. If you remember, this is like 4 or 5 seasons ago when the iPhone, the format was, it had a flat bottom so you could just stand it up, right? I think 4 or 5. And so this company, Cycloramic, made an app that used the sensors in there and the audio and the buzzing capability to make it turn to create a panoramic picture. And they had technology and computer vision technology in their way ahead of their time that stitched it all together. Well, when they changed the feature and the layout of the iPhone, that didn't work anymore. So we made them pivot into pure computer vision. And we took that same technology, and they were at Georgia Tech, their internet group, there in this whole section, they have this really cool. And we made them pivot into pure computer vision, and we started using it for car applications on the internet. So that even back then, over the past couple years, you can go to different car sites, and you can rotate it, use your finger, or use your mouse to look at the car from different angles. Open up the door, walk into the car. Well, 9 months ago, probably now, Carvana bought them with cash and stock for like $40 million. So my $250K for 20% or whatever it was turned out pretty good.
Right.
Yeah. And so, it was a great case of Bruno, the entrepreneur, and bringing in a CEO and pivoting and using technology and recognizing what truly is differentiated computer vision and creating applications and vertical needs that, vertical solutions that work.
So speaking of good investments, in January of 2000, you bought the Dallas Mavericks. You paid Ross Perot $285 million. It's now up about 7 times that.
Oh, more than that.
It's, unless my math is wrong.
Yeah.
What's it worth?
No, you don't listen to Forbes, do you?
I do.
Is that how you buy your stocks and make your investments?
You tell me what it's worth. The stock market usually, the price.
How much you got?
You think it's invaluable. More than $2
billion? Oh, yeah. Are you kidding me? Yeah, with... there are so few forms of programming. Well, let me take a step back. Think of it this way. The difference with professional sports in particular, we'll see. I don't know what Apple reported. If Apple, not this quarter. Let's just say somebody reports, Google reports just the biggest quarter ever, and their stock goes flying. Nobody throws a parade, Your favorite team, wherever you may live, or when the Mavs won in 2011, the whole city's on fire. People, that's all you can think about. That's all you can talk about. Everywhere you turn, all media, everybody's attitude is different because your team is going to the Super Bowl, the finals, or whatever it is. That type of commitment, that type of connection doesn't happen in any other business, period. And so
But from a valuation perspective,
right? But that's part of it. That's part of it.
Not every team, and you've said this before, not every team makes money.
Right? No, they don't all make money, but in terms of being a destination for media, right? Because now, so we went from, it was okay being on television. It was a good deal once you went to cable. It drove subscriptions. To now TV's kind of falling off the map, so it's the only thing driving appointment viewing other than news, and it's, different and more positive and aspirational than news. And now you have streaming on the internet. The thing about streaming on the internet, whether it's Netflix or Hulu or Amazon or whatever, it's hard to create hits. Netflix has got to spend unbelievable amounts of money in order to X percentage of their shows to be, watched in destination shows so people retain their subscriptions. And with sports, and on Netflix, none of those are destination appointment viewing. Right, you just watch when you watch. With sports, if you're online and you want to be destination appointment viewing, you're gonna have to pay a lot of money. So the valuation of our broadcast rights are going to keep on going up, right? Because online it's harder to create destination programming, particularly time-driven destination programming, than it is for traditional TV, because there's unlimited number of choices.
Right.
And so, you know, I think that's going to really pay off for us. So I think, you know, I'm bullish.
What do you think it's worth?
What's that?
What do you think it's worth?
Doesn't matter. I'm not going to sell it, but.
And the Rockets traded a year or two ago at 2.2. You're worth more than Houston?
Absolutely. $10 billion. It doesn't matter. Yeah.
Okay. So along with the purchase, not only was the purchase of the Mavs a financial success, mm-hmm. but it was a pretty stark reversal in fortunes for the team as well. When Mark bought them in 2000, they had 10 consecutive losing seasons. From that moment on, they had 16 consecutive winning seasons, culminating in the first championship in 2011. What did you do from a management perspective that sort of so quickly reversed the fortunes of the team?
I mean, I worked really hard. And I did a lot of research, and I recognized as I looked around the locker room, we had this 7-foot guy from Germany who was really, 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 right. really good. And from there, I just got out of the way.
And that's an important point, right? Because Nowitzki, Nash, Finley, they were all on the team before you bought them.
Yeah, they were there, but everybody was trying to trade them and say they were horrible. They all had been booed. And I got there, we were 9-23, and I walked in and said, okay, we're going to start trying to win. If you want to try to win, stay here. And if you don't, you just want to collect a check, let me know and I'll trade you anywhere. And that worked. And so we started, turned around, finished 31-19 and had 10 straight 50-plus winning seasons. But, you know, Father Time's undefeated. The last 2 years haven't been as good, but, you know, hopefully, where's the wood? This last guy we drafted last year, Luka Doncic, is the real deal, which he sure appears to be. 19 years old and already one of the top players in the NBA. It's incredible.
Yeah. He got more All-Star votes than Steph Curry.
Yes.
Which is pretty remarkable.
It's unbelievable. And he's a good kid.
Yeah.
He does two things in life. Three. Eats, plays basketball, and plays Fortnite. And I have to struggle to keep those priorities ordered correctly.
Is he your best Fortnite player on the team, or you don't know?
My 9-year-old crush. No.
So it's interesting with Doncic, obviously, because... you know, Dirk Nowitzki, this is his 21st consecutive season with the Mavericks. I think that's an NBA record for most with a team. Not announced whether this is his last or not, but he was just invited to, be in the All-Star game in the three-point shooting contest.
Yeah.
So, you know, it must be bittersweet for you to some degree, but it's a pretty neat sort of passing of the torch to a degree.
Yeah, Dirk is the best.
How would you say they're similar?
Yeah, I mean, look, they're similar. They're both European. They both have their own unique styles. They bring something different that the NBA really hadn't seen. To their games, but they're just good people. You know, Dirk's just a great guy. I mean, I've had more moments with him off the court than I have had on the court. he's just a unique individual. And Luka has a lot of those same qualities, and it's cool to see Dirk kind of convey and support and educate Luka on how to carry himself, because there's a lot of different ways a kid today can be a professional. And learning how to do it in a manner that you're always looking to get better, you always treat people with respect, you're always supportive of the fans because they pay your salary. And recognizing that is critical, I think, to working your way to being something special in this league. And Dirk does a great job educating Luka and all our young guys, Jalen Brunson, et cetera.
All right. So you've always been a fan-first owner.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you wear your emotions on your sleeve. And even from the get-go, you know, in your first year, whether it's post-game commentary, you've earned plenty of discipline from the league.
Yep.
Mark is actually the most fined individual in the history of the NBA. and what's funny is I can tell a personal story. Your first suspension actually affected me personally, whether you remember this or not. The very first season, your first full season, you had invited me down to a game to sit courtside with you for the defending champion Lakers with Shaq and Kobe, and I was all fired up to go.
And I got suspended.
And it's a few days before the game.
They wouldn't let me in the building at all.
And I turn on SportsCenter, and all of a sudden the top story was David Stern suspends Mark Cuban. First time this ever happened. Two games he's not allowed in Reunion Arena for the Chalupa incident, which... Remember the Chalupa incident?
Yeah, the Chalupa incident.
I'll fill everyone. We have some time, so I'll tell the story. So the Chalupa incident, it was a game against the Cavaliers. I think the Mavs were up like 98-70 something with, you know, a couple of minutes left.
And a couple seconds.
And well, they didn't score for several minutes,
right,
from what I recall. And there was a promotion that the Mavericks had that if the team scored 100 points in a game, everyone in the arena gets a free chalupa. So even though it's 99 cents, you know, usually when a team is up by a lot of points, it's the courtesy thing to slow the game down. They couldn't score that final 100th point. And so with, you know, 30 seconds left, they're running up and down, shooting threes. The fans are chanting, you know, chalupa, chalupa, chalupa.
Literally, 18,000 people were chalupa, chalupa.
And needless to say, the Cavaliers, you know, took some offense to the fact that they were still kind of running up the score. And there was a little scuffle after the game.
Well, it wasn't a scuffle. So Gary Trent goes, and the fans are screaming, and he goes to shoot it. And Tractor Trailer, rest in peace, starts banging his head, knocks him over, and bangs his head on the floor.
So what did you do?
I ran out there thinking, what? Of course you're going to run out trying to help your guy. And the refs are freaking out, get your ass back. And then I realized, oh, I'm not supposed to do this. I'd only been in the league how long? And so that's why I got suspended.
So I got a two-game suspension, and I'm like, okay.
Because I would have kicked Tractor Trailer's ass. It would have been no question.
So
it all worked out, though. I think you end up wearing those Groucho Marx glasses and the mustache.
Yeah, I'd hit upstairs, no.
No, I didn't do that. We did go, though. Speaking of fines, you received actually your biggest record fine last year was $600,000 for saying losing might be our best option, which was, you know, and the thing.
Even though everybody does it, we just can't say it.
Yeah, and the reason is, you know, once they were sort of out of playoff contention, at that point you're kind of racing towards last because then you get a top draft pick. So my question was, you know, in a salary cap era, where you know the salary cap really enforces parity for all the teams.
For the most part, yeah.
Do you think it's rewarding bad performance too much to also reward failure with getting a top draft pick? Should the draft be random?
Random, no, but you can make a lot of different arguments in a lot of different directions, right? On where you want to incent people and how teams can get better. That's part of the challenge and the strategy of running a team. Because there is no obvious answer. There's a lot of teams that have worked really hard to get really high draft picks, and it hasn't worked out for them. And then, you know, I get fined $600,000. We only end up with the fifth best pick, but we make a trade, and we choose Luka Doncic, which has turned out to be a great pick for us. You know, Michael Jordan wasn't the first pick in the draft. It's just talent evaluation is tough. You know, building a team and strategizing on the best way to approach it is tough too. So, you know, I'm not trying to talk around the question, but there's no easy answer.
But behaviorally, and this isn't specific to the NBA, in sports today, you know, what industry is there that rewards failure like that? In the sense that you finish last,
industry.
Salary cap.
All you got to do to go to Silicon Valley and say, buy growth and lose more money.
Right. But if, you know, if there was a ranking for Goldman Sachs and we finished number one and suddenly we couldn't draft the best, you know, recruits at college, that would seem a little silly, right?
Yeah,
It's a multi-billion dollar industry as well.
Obviously, it's different because there's only 450 positions in the league and there's constrained talent. And, you know, faith favors the talent with the successful, right? You have an inherent advantage. When we were winning championships, we would have had a huge advantage in getting young talent versus not doing so well the last 2 years. And so it's hard. Effectively, it's worked. It just hasn't worked all the time for everybody.
Right. So you've never been shy to speak up on issues. As anyone here who hasn't met Mark before, you've obviously figured that out in the first half hour here. But you've never been shy to speak up on issues that are important to you.
Yep.
And one of those themes I've found has been around fairness.
Uh-huh.
And whether that's, you know, calling out referees for not calling games consistently or, you know, calling out a Shark Tank contestant because you think that they're scamming their customers.
Right.
How do you decide what you're going to speak up on or do you hold inside?
You know, it's changed over the years because I have kids, because social media, you know, Twitter in particular is so much different and has changed kind of the rules of engagement. It's changed because of what I went through with the Mavericks last year. I missed a sexual harassment problem that we had because I took my eye off the ball. I try to be self-aware and try to put myself in the shoes of the person or people or organization I'm talking about, whether it adds value. I try to put myself in the position, my own position, you know, how's it going to be perceived and, you know, is it worth it? You know, will it create more good than challenges?
Right.
And so you've got to pick your spots.
You've always been open in regards to your faith. And I'll quote you. Being Jewish has given me a foundation for everything I am and everything I hope to be. We've recently seen a rise in anti-Semitism, and specifically, you know, the horrific incident in your hometown of Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
What do you think is the driver of this increase in anti-Semitism and hate crimes in general? And what do you think can be done about it?
You know, I think in the past, if you had really prejudiced views or racist views, you kind of were alone in a corner. And then the internet came along, and maybe you were in a Usenet group, or maybe you were in a private forum, or even a Facebook group, and you kind of stayed there. But now, you know, you're not alone. And, you know, some people argue, well, it's the president, he enables this. I don't know, but I do know that, you know, if you've got 20, 30, 50, 100 people that you can talk to that are supportive of your anti-Semitism, your racism, your xenophobia, whatever it may be, then you're a lot more likely to stand out, or a lot more likely to do something.
It's easy to create your own echo chamber.
Yeah, and so in terms of what you do about it, you know, we've just got to be really cognizant of, and you know, I think those places that host have got to be a lot more transparent. And so there should, you know, there's ways to offer privacy and still be transparent with all the new technology that's coming through today, right? And so, you know, using AI, using video recognition, using NLP, there's ways to go through and identify, not just with keywords, but you can sentiment analysis and the like, so that you can red flag areas and introduce new people. But Facebook, and you know, this gets to the topic of regulation, but at some point, those doors have got to be open, so that wherever you are in the internet, there's got to be access to that from the host to third parties to be able to look for those types of problems and identify them early.
You're someone who has been mentioned previously as a potential presidential candidate.
Uh-huh.
I think you told Maureen Dowd a year or two ago that it's approximately an 11% chance that you run in 2020. You know, and I will say that, you know, you clearly seem to be the type of candidate that a lot of people thought they were getting with President Trump. Right, an outspoken,
I don't know how to take that.
An outspoken.
We're not alike in
there.
Well, first of all, let's argue about that. But
what they thought.
Yeah.
Outspoken,
yeah,
self-made like billionaire, him. Not beholden to special interests.
No.
Even
no,
then, no.
No. Hell no. Right.
You're beholden to special interests.
No. There's no comparison.
You don't want to brand yourself anywhere close to president.
No. Not even. I've used spray tan before, but.
Is that it?
That's it. But no, nothing like him at all. And in terms of percentages, look, it's a long shot. You know the definition of bad parenting? Having kids 9, 12, and 15 and running for president. I mean, my son still thinks I hung the moon, right? And I talked about Twitter and the issues there. You just get doxxed to death. And, you know, I just don't know if I'm ready for that. But I'm not closing the door yet. Simply because if you look at candidates right now, I think like AOC is really impressive. I think Kamala Harris was really impressive with her speech. Howard Schultz, I don't think handled it the right way, but I think even across all of them, they kind of take the same approach. You know, this is the way traditional politics, exclusive of Donald Trump, this is the way it's been done, right? And so you go out there and you give a speech and you say, here's why I'm special and here's what I believe. Here's what I think needs to change. Here's, you know, the other people who are doing it wrong. Here's how I think we can do this, right? But nobody gives specifics.
Right.
Yet we know what the problems are.
But why is that, though? I mean, isn't it because people don't respond? I mean,
no, because they deal with polling all the time.
They poll people, and people
only ask the questions that are driven by what they find online and on traditional media, right? So people don't wake up every, immigration's an issue, but people don't wake up every morning thinking about immigration,
right?
Right?
And they're not weighing all the different, the specifics of all the different proposals, but walls.
Not even the proposals, right? It's not like if you're looking at all the proposals that have come from politicians, the chances are 99% none of them are gonna work, right? But if you know the problem, let's go think through a solution and try to put it together. Now, it may not be politically expedient, it might be hard to do. So when you hear these solutions, they're not solutions. They're just talking points that everybody can kind of rally around and talk about. So to answer your question, if I come up with solutions, then I have something to ride in on. So I've been working on healthcare, right? And I've been putting something together. I put together a program called the 10 Plan. And I'm working my way up the ladder. Now, just real quickly, what's the 10 plan? if you took the money that was allocated to the ACA, you pulled out the insurance companies, and you said, you know what? In this country, if you want to borrow money from the SBA, we'll loan you money. If you want to borrow money for college, we'll loan you the money. The government will guarantee or loan it, and we'll do a means testing to let you pay back. If you're about to die and can't get a heart transplant, we won't loan you money. So I said, okay, that's not right. What do big companies like Goldman Sachs, Mark Cuban companies, what do? Right? We self-insure. We might use an insurance company to moderate and implement the paperwork, but we self-insure. So I went to a far left economist and I said, okay, imagine we took insurance out because insurance is not a wellness plan, right? It's just a financial instrument. And if you want to buy it, fine. But we took that ACA money and we just used it to guarantee people's loan, and we made people responsible for paying for their own healthcare. No insurance, so you don't pay in, right? So if you don't use any healthcare, it costs you nothing. But so I said, use these parameters. If I go to the doctor and I break my leg and it's $1,000, I limit the amount someone pays to 10% of their check. So if I make, you know, $4,000 a month, I pay 10% of that $400 a month to what's paid off. If I have a really bad incident and if I have some chronic disease and it costs me $1 million a year, I still only pay 10%. And after 15 years, it's all waived. You don't pay anymore. There's no medical insurance. There's no medical bankruptcy, nothing. And I said, score it for me like you score the ACA or any other plans. They wanted to rip it apart because they were part of creating the ACA. It works. And it saves $85 billion a year. Now, what am I doing with it next? I'm working my way up the ladder. Made presentations to different potential presidential candidates, getting positive feedback. Went to HHS, positive feedback. To me, that's what's missing. Right. Don't talk about, wow, I believe in this, and I believe. Talk about what you're going to do.
Right, but isn't that the issue? I mean, like, it's a great idea, but is that going to win an election? Or
doesn't matter. If it fixes, so if I have my choice between being the president or fixing healthcare, sign me up for fixing healthcare.
Yeah, you've right? got to be in that position first.
No, you don't. You don't. And that's the whole point. You guys are very Darwinian. You're in a very Darwinian business where good ideas and great execution mean hopefully great results. Why should it be any different for paying for healthcare? Why can't we use the resources that are available? So now I'm pushing to get exemptions from CMS and other places. And it's going to be a slog. It's not going to happen overnight. There's some people who agree with different things and disagree with different things, and we're incorporating them all. But it can work, right? And so those are the types of things that when people say, well, are you going to run? Well, if I come up with solutions for this and other problems, then yeah.
Sounds like you've got solutions.
That's one, and we don't have time for the others.
Yeah. All right, so let's get to the lightning round. A blog that covers the Mavs is called The Smoking Cuban.
Uh-huh.
What's the funniest play in your name you've ever heard?
Cubano, Fidel Castro, smoke a Cuban, light one up, you know, yeah.
Choose one, being given a cloak of invisibility or live to be 200 years old?
Live to be 200 years old.
What's your go-to shot and horse?
My go-to shot and horse, off to the side, out of bounds on the right-hand side, behind the three-point line, corner three.
Behind the whole corner? Or
yeah, out of bounds, outside the corner.
The angle.
It's tough to do over the edge of the backboard. Nothing but net.
What's your FICO score? Do you know?
I don't, but it's improved since I've had multiple credit cards cut up. So, yeah, it's improved a lot.
It was. Yeah. Best player to ever suit up for the Mavs?
Dirk.
Best person to ever suit up for the Mavs?
Dirk.
Will the first female head coach be in the NBA or the NFL?
The NBA.
Who's your favorite opposing NBA coach?
Pop.
I was going to say you can't include Popovich.
Yeah, can't include Popovich. I don't know, they change so often. Yeah, Pop.
Most prized baseball card as a kid?
Willie Stargell.
If you could learn the absolute truth to one question, what question would you ask?
What's the meaning of life?
What's on the lock screen of your phone?
My kids. Pictures of my kids.
Who wins in a 40-yard dash, Nowitzki or you? You've already said nice things about him.
It's going to be close.
And the last one, what's your favorite quote or advice?
The one thing in life you can control is your effort.
Yeah. I will say, if I could say my favorite quote of yours is never stop learning, never stop grinding, never stop loving every single minute of your life.
Amen.
Which is he lives his life, and it's a great example for everyone. All right, well, Mark, thank you very
much, Brian,
for being here.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.